Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to the series called RBI 247. In this very series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try to discuss them with the help of different questions. So for all those who are watching this video for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and notifications. You can also join our Telegram group. In this very group, we share some free quizzes, the updates for all our videos, and you can also post your queries over here. So moving on to question number one, which of the following PPI regulations proposed by RBI with bi-monthly monetary policy of April 2021 have now been finally mandated as on May 2021 by the central bank? So regarding PPI, if I talk about PPI, they stand for your prepaid payment instruments. So we have already had one session where I discussed in detail about these prepaid payment instruments. So you can watch that session on the YouTube itself. I'll not discuss again what are these prepaid payment instruments. Okay, thoroughly they have been discussed. So this question talks about the bi-monthly policy, monetary policy of April 2021. Let's discuss about it a bit. So when RBI came up with the bi-monthly policy for the month of April, okay, it decided on maintaining, RBI decided on maintaining the accommodative stance. So that monetary policy talked about what will be the reserve ratios which have to be maintained and what stance is the RBI maintaining with regard to its monetary policy. So more or less the rates were kept same, taking into consideration the present pandemic situation. Other than that, if you visit the RBI website for the month of April, you will also see that RBI came up with some regulations regarding your prepaid payment instruments as well, regarding your payment and settlement system. So let us have a look at those regulations or the guidelines which RBI suggested, and now those guidelines have finally been mandated. So let us have a look at it. Now if I talk about that bi-monthly monetary policy, along with that, what was announced regarding PPIs was that PPI interoperability will be made mandatory. This was the first thing. Second was that regarding the full KYC PPI, so ones who are having PPIs which are having full KYC approved, then if the minimum limit for those PPIs was rupees 1 lakh, it will now be increased to rupees 2 lakh. And third was that the non-bank PPI issuers, okay, who have issued the PPI and those PPI are full KYC PPIs, then you can withdraw the cash using those PPIs as well. So let's discuss a bit about it in detail and what RBI has now decided regarding these three provisions. So talking about interoperability, RBI has mandated the interoperability and it shall be enabled by 31st March 2022. So what is this interoperability? Interoperability ka matlab kya hota hai? It is basically technical compatibility. If you are running one payment settlement system or one payment option, then how easily compatible is it with another payment system? For example, if you have a SBI Bank ATM card and you go to a ICICI Bank ATM, so using this card you can withdraw the money at some other bank's ATM as well. This is interoperability. Ek payment and settlement system, ek prepaid payment instrument, ya ek bank ya entity ki service aap dusri se kaise avail kar sakte ho, dono ke beech compatibility hai ki nahi, that is interoperability. Okay, the technical compatibility which exists. So regarding that, RBI has said that it will be mandatory for the PPI issuers that they give the holders of full KYC PPIs the interoperability. Jinke PPIs ne puri KYC requirements meet ki hui hai, wo PPIs apne, jaise agar unka ek entity ka ya ek particular payment provider ka unke paas PPI hai, to wo uski service dusri jagah se bhi avail kar sakte hai. Jaise kisi ke paas SBI ka ATM card hai, to ICICI se bhi wo paisa withdraw kar sakte hai. Now RBI has authorized this not only for your card networks but also for your e-wallets and all, where they will use UPI for your PPI interoperability. So if you are having, say, e-wallet of Paytm, using that you can also avail the services, or you can also transfer the money or use the money which is there in MobiKwik wallet. So this is the interoperability which should exist. Okay, Google Pay, say aap Paytm अपने पेटीएम वॉलेट में अमाउंट ट्रांसफर कर लोगे या MobiKwik वॉलेट से आप पेटीएम में ट्रांसफर करोगे, दैट इज इंटरऑपरेबिलिटी. सो इंटरऑपरेबिलिटी नीड्स टू बी अलाउड फॉर ऑल फुल केवाईसी पीपीआईज बाय 31st March 2022. नाउ दिस शुड नॉट ओनली बी फॉर योर पीपीआईज विच आर ऑपरेटिंग थ्रू दी इन द फॉर्म ऑफ कार्ड्स, बट ऑल्सो फॉर योर ई वॉलेट काइंड ऑफ पीपीआईज. दिस वॉज द फर्स्ट थिंग. Talking about the second, RBI has increased the limit for full KYC PPIs. So those who are having full KYC PPIs, unke agar PPI ki maximum limit 1 lakh, the, some of the wallets and all offer that maximum limit, then that has been increased to 2 lakh. So this is the amount, maximum amount which you can have outstanding in such full KYC PPIs. Third is permitting the cash withdrawal. So earlier, if you were having an ATM card, then only, or a debit card, using that you could withdraw the money from your ATMs. Okay, उसके through आप ATMs, आपके पास कोई debit card या ATM card था, तो उसके through आप ATM जाके money withdraw कर सकते थे. But now what RBI has allowed, that the full KYC PPIs which are issued by non-bank PPIs, you using them also you can withdraw the cash. So non-bank कौन-कौन से हो गए, आपका Paytm हो गया, MobiKwik हो गया. Okay, so all these are not banks, but they offer you e-wallets and other such options. So now if they are full KYC approved, then using them also you will be able to withdraw the money. जो पहले आप सिर्फ कार्ड से कर सकते थे, वो अब आप इन PPIs के थ्रू भी कर सकोगे, जो आपके e-wallets वगैरह हैं. RBI has approved that. And the maximum limit for the same is 2,000 per transaction with an overall limit of 10,000 per month per PPI. So these are the actions which have been mandated by RBI now. Moving back to our question, we had to identify the regulations which were proposed and mandated by RBI. So first one says that it shall be mandatory for PPI issuers to give the holders of full KYC PPIs interoperability. Yes, this is correct. Second one says maximum amount outstanding will be decreased from 2 to 1 lakh. No, it's not going to be decreased. Rather, it's going to be increased from 1 lakh to 2 lakhs now. This statement is incorrect. Third one is again correct, because it says that cash withdrawal will be permitted to full KYC PPIs issued by non-bank PPIs. So first and third are correct. Answer is option C. Moving on to question number 2. It says that RBI came up with support window of 10,000 crore, which was carved out for small businesses. But RBI efforts to accelerate the lending to small firms have hit a roadblock, with small finance banks opting just to borrow about 400 crores out of the 10,000 crores allocated. The RBI's first special 3-year long-term operation, repo operation, that is the SLTRO, on 17 May saw a muted response, with 7 out of 10 banks skipping it. Which of the following is a major reason for banks not availing this loan facility? So in one of the sessions where I talked about the steps which are taken by RBI to deal with second wave of COVID, there I talked about this facility. So I told you that RBI is providing a 10,000 crore support where SLTRO has been conducted, and under this the small finance banks can borrow from RBI amount where the maximum limit has been set up as 10,000 crore. So RBI 10,000 crore in operations ke liye rakhega, and under this the small finance banks can borrow from RBI and they can use those loans to lend to your small business unit, to your micro small industries and other unorganized and or other organized and unorganized sectors which are badly hit due to the pandemic. So it was carved out for small businesses, which the lenders say that are suffering because of COVID uncertainty. Now, if I talk about the current status of this facility, recently only this facility was offered. But if you have a look at it, only 400 crore loans have been taken up till now out of this 10,000 crore limit, which is specified. Okay. Now, RBI's effort to lend more to the small firms is hitting a roadblock. ये जो इनकी facility थी, it is seeing a muted response. So why is a muted response coming? Why only 3 banks out of every 10 are opting for this and 7 of the banks are skipping this loan facility? जो ये आपके small finance banks हैं, ये loan क्यों नहीं ले रहे इस facility के अंदर? Let us have a look at it. Why there are only few takers of loans? So we'll be looking at the reasons for banks not availing the loans. Now why will a bank, a small finance bank, take a loan? The banks provide the funding to your people who need it or the businesses who need it. Loans provide karte hai banks, okay, banks provide the loans. So RBI came up with facility where the banks will borrow from RBI and they will lend it to the people, to the small businesses. इसीलिए बोरो करेंगे ताकि वो फर्दर लेंड कर सके. आरबीआई से जो एसएलटीआरओ के अंडर लोन्स लेगा बैंक, वो लोन्स बैंक स्मॉल बिजनेसेस को देगा विच आर सफरिंग बिकॉज ऑफ कोविड. सो नाउ व्हाट इज हैपनिंग, दी स्मॉल बिजनेसेस आर नॉट डिमांडिंग दी लोन्स, दे आर सफरिंग बिकॉज ऑफ द पैंडमिक, दे आर नॉट डूइंग वेल, जिसकी वजह से उनको अब लोन्स की जरूरत अभी नहीं है. उनकी एपेटाइट ऐसी नहीं है कि वो लोन्स लेंगे और वो रीपे कर पाएंगे. दैट्स वाई बिजनेसेस आर नॉट प्रेफरिंग टू टेक लोन्स, ओके, बिकॉज दे फील दे डोंट हैव द एपेटाइट टू पे बैक देम. दैट्स वाई दे आर नॉट डिमांडिंग द लोन्स. सो द बैंकर्स से दैट द एपेटाइट ऑफ स्मॉल फर्म्स टू बोरो because of the uncertainty due to the pandemic is impacting these banks. जब ये banks, जब ये businesses amount borrow ही नहीं कर सकते, उनकी appetite ही नहीं है, then obviously they will not take loans from banks. And when they don't take loans from banks, there is no need for banks to borrow the money, क्योंकि bank borrow ही इसलिए कर रहा था ताकि वो further lend कर सके. Small banks are borrowing less than expected and thus the need to borrow more to further lend is less. बैंक्स के लिए कोई नीड नहीं है स्मॉल फाइनेंस बैंक्स के लिए कि वो बोरो करे, क्योंकि फर्दर लेंडिंग ही नहीं है, मार्केट में क्रेडिट डिमांड ही नहीं है. देर इज नॉट मच क्रेडिट डिमांड बाय दी स्मॉल बिजनेसेस. दस द नीड ऑफ बैंक्स टू बोरो फ्रॉम आरबीआई अंडर एसएलटीआरओ एंड लेंड टू स्मॉल बिजनेसेस इज अगेन फॉलिंग. द करेंट पोजिशन इज सच दैट द स्मॉल फाइनेंस बैंक्स आर फ्लश्ड अप विद फंड्स बट द लोन ग्रोथ इज वेरी लिटिल. इनके पास बहुत फंड्स है, जो स्मॉल फाइनेंस बैंक्स है ना, दे आर फ्लश्ड अप विद फंड्स बट द डिमांड फॉर लोन्स इज नॉट देयर, इट्स वेरी लिटिल. दिस इज वन मेजर रीजन. सेकेंड मेजर रीजन विच कम्स अप इज द डेडलाइन इम्पोज्ड बाय आरबीआई ऑन द स्मॉल फाइनेंस बैंक्स. So what has RBI done? RBI has imposed a deadline where whatever loans are taken by these small finance banks from RBI under this SLTRO facility, they have to be deployed within 30 days. Taking into consideration the present situation, the banks are not able to approach the small businesses to provide the funding because of the pandemic, or small businesses, if they want loan, they are also not able to approach the banks because of the lockdowns imposed. So it's very difficult to meet this 30-day deadline. अगर 30 डेज में जो बैंक ने आरबीआई से लोन लिया है वो उन्हें फर्दर लेंड करना है, लेकिन वो लॉकडाउन की वजह से, कोविड की वजह से लोगों तक पहुंच ही नहीं पा रहे लोन देने के लिए, देन ऑब्वियसली दिस 30-day डेडलाइन couldn't be met. So that's the reason why the small finance banks are not opting for this facility now. जब उन्हें ज़रूरत पड़ेगी, जब उनको दिखेगा कि हाँ small businesses की डिमांड है, तभी वो आरबीआई से लोन लेंगे, अदरवाइज दे विल नॉट. So RBI has decided that it will conduct this SLTRO once a month till October to make sure that this unused portion of 10,000 crore gets used up and the small finance banks borrow it. So this was the news piece which I wanted to discuss, which talked about few takers for the loans. So which of the following is a major reasons of banks not availing the loans? The answer to this question is option D. The appetite of small firms to borrow amidst the uncertainty. Okay. आरबीआई ने कोई और फैसिलिटी के अंदर लोन्स ऑफर किए हैं, ये इसका रीज़न नहीं है कि वो एसएलटीआरओ के अंडर लोन्स नहीं लेंगे. आर बैंक्स के पास इनफ बफर है इसलिए उन्हें नीड नहीं है. दिस इज ऑल्सो नॉट अ रीज़न फॉर बैंक्स नॉट ऑप्टिंग फॉर एसएलटीआरओ. एंड सेम गोज फॉर द थर्ड वन. ओके, सो आंसर इज ऑप्शन डी. मूविंग ऑन टू क्वेश्चन नंबर 3, इट सेज RBI has approved the transfer of ₹99,122 crores as surplus to the central government for the accounting period of 9 months ended 31st March. So, which of the following options correctly states the source of earning this surplus for RBI? So, let us have a look at this thing which was recently in news. So, RBI has decided to pay this much crore surplus to the center. Now, you must be knowing that RBI when started up was a private bank, okay, but then it was nationalized. So, who is the major shareholder of RBI now? The central government. Okay, now if you have invested in some company, if you are a shareholder, then obviously the company will pay you some returns, some dividends. So, who is the major shareholder of RBI? The central government. So, RBI needs to pay some dividends to the central government. This is the concept of surplus. RBI kuch surplus apna dividends ke form mein ya profits ke form mein central bank ke saath share, central government ke saath share karte hai. Okay, so the central bank pays dividends to the government every year from the surplus it generates from its market operations, from investments, from printing of currency, etc. So now for this year, RBI has decided to transfer 99,122 crores to the government from its profit, from the surplus it has. So, 9 months ka jo period tha, which ended on 31st March, that is from July 2020 to 31st March, the RBI calculated the surplus and has decided to transfer this much amount to the central government. Okay, so this is for the period of July to March. Now, why this 9 month surplus has been calculated and not for entire 12 months? Because RBI is trying to shift its accounting year from April to March. Pehle wo July se June tak ka year follow karte the. Now they want to shift to the April to March, jo aapka central government follow karti hai. That's why they have calculated the 9 month surplus and is paying the same to the central government. Along with that, RBI has also decided that it will maintain the contingency risk buffer at 5.5%. So, ye contingency risk buffer kya hota hai? Contingency risk buffer is the capital that organization needs to hold as counter against unforeseen events. कोई unforeseen event हो सकता है, loss हो सकता है, future में कोई ऐसी condition आ सकती है जब आपको पैसों की जरूरत पड़ेगी. So in that case, RBI maintains some capital for the same. So 5.5% is the rate which has been decided. Bimal Jalan committee recommended to have this buffer at around 5.5 to 6.5%. So RBI chose the lower one and 5.5% buffer RBI maintains. After maintaining this much buffer, RBI has decided that it is going to transfer 99,122 crores to the center. Now talking about this decision, if you visit the RBI website, you will have a notification regarding the 589th meeting of the central board. So this meeting happened through video conferencing and in this very meeting, this thing has been decided. So RBI has recently switched to April-March fiscal from the earlier July to June. And thus this 9 month period payment has been made. So in 2021-22, this much amount has been decided. So you can see it's one of the highest amount, around second highest amount hai. Sabse zyada jo tha wo tha aapka 2018-19 mein, sabse zyada surplus jo transfer kiya gaya tha. Uske baad ab itne saalon baad ye maximum, ye second highest amount hai which is being transferred by RBI to the central government. The amount which was budgeted to be transferred was 50,000. So, this expectation was that 50,000 ka amount is by surplus ke form mein government ko diya jayega. But almost double amount is being provided. Last year, around 57,000 crores was a surplus amount which was given, and this time we have seen a rise. Now, talking about Why? That is why RBI is transferring this much surplus to the government. I've already told you that as a return, as a dividend under the RBI Act, it is mandatory that RBI transfers the surplus, the excess of income which is has over the expenditure to the government. So it is transferring this surplus. Okay. Now it is going to, considering the present pandemic situation, it is going to help the center deal with its fiscal deficit to keep it in check, and it will also aid the government finances. Government is required to carry out a lot of expenditures. Government pandemic ki wajah se bahut zyada expenditures incur kar rahi hai, and the government can't stop those expenditures. Now, although from disinvestments government might earn something, but that's not enough. Okay, so it needs more funding, and RBI is helping out with by providing that funding. Other reason is the providing a buffer, that is higher surplus transfer will provide a buffer to absorb losses from the tax revenues. Now, because the businesses are suffering, so we are likely to see a dip in the GST collected, then the direct taxes which are also, and also in the direct taxes which are collected from the corporates. Corporates itna acha function nahi kar pa rahe. Inflation is high, their profits are not that good. So we might see a fall in the GST indirect tax collection as well as in the direct tax collection. So this amount will act as a buffer for the government, which will compensate for the loss of tax revenues. Then government, as I've already told you, government is under pressure to incur the expenditure to spend some amount to spur investment and growth in the economy. Now, even this much surplus is not sufficient. Government will also go for disinvestment and other options so that it is able to generate some more money to deal with the situation of the pandemic. Now we are saying that RBI is transferring this much surplus, this much profit, this much earnings to the government. Where does the RBI's earnings come from? RBI ke paas surplus kaise aa raha hai? So there are different ways in which RBI can earn. So let us look at some of them. One of them is the open market operations. So RBI buys and sells bonds to maintain the liquidity in the economy. So when it's buying the bonds, it will earn some interest on those bonds, and then the bond prices might change in a favorable manner, which will profit RBI. So bonds pe interest earn karke ya bond ki value appreciate hoti hai, to RBI can earn from the open market operations. Second is the dealings in the foreign exchange market. RBI might buy and sell some foreign currency and make profit in return. So it might buy dollars cheaply today and sell it at a higher value in future, and thus will make some gains. Thirdly, there can be some money generated out of revaluing the foreign assets, the gold. RBI ke paas kuch gold, kuch foreign assets ho sakte hain, unki value appreciate hogi to RBI earn karega. Then a wider spread between reverse repo and repo rate. So this spread is actually the difference between the repo and the reverse repo rate. The rate at which RBI lends to banks and the rate which RBI offers on the amount deposited by the banks with RBI. So this rate, RBI is lending at 4% to RBI ko 4% milega. And the banks which are parking their money with RBI, RBI will pay them 3.35. Which of the following options correctly states the source of earning this surplus? So the answer is interest received by RBI on bond it buys during OMOs. So interest paid jo hoga, jo interest RBI pay karega, that is not going to be a earning. Depreciation in value of gold is not going to be an earning. Okay, appreciation will be an earning. Okay, then not lower but higher spread can help with the earnings. Then RBI agar profits kamayega dealings in foreign exchange se, to wo earning hogi. That's why the answer is option E. Moving on to last question of the day. It says, the apex court of the country has upheld the validity of center's notification allowing the banks to proceed against personal guarantors for recovery of loans given to the company under IBC. Which of the following purposes will this move not serve? So ye not word important hai. Now, what has happened? At times, the promoters of the companies, they give personal guarantee that if the company is not able to repay the loan, we'll pay. We'll guarantee, we are guaranteeing that companies will pay. So Reliance Industries say has taken a loan on a personal guarantee of Anil Ambani. Now, what Anil Ambani says is that my assets should not be personally held liable for paying companies' defaults. But the banks say, jinhone loan diya hai, the banks which have given loan to people like, to companies like Reliance under the personal guarantee of Anil Ambani, they, such lenders, such banks say that no, you should be personally held liable because you gave personal guarantee. So that was the clash. In November, Supreme Court's one of the notification talked about that, stating that recovery proceedings can happen against the individuals who are giving personal guarantees. So, but again, despite of that, the people were claiming that no, we'll not be personally held liable, and the lenders were claiming that they should be held liable. So Supreme Court has again given a verdict. It has said that that previous notification is valid, it's correct. So what can happen now? If under someone's personal guarantee, corporate loans have been granted, then the proceedings can happen against those individuals as well. What the people like Anil Ambani were claiming, they were saying that, okay, on our personal guarantee, the corporate has taken loan, but our personal assets should not be held liable when the recovery is happening under IBC. तो वो कहते हैं कि IBC के अंडर हमारी रिकवरी हो रही है, NPA रेजोल्यूशन प्रोसेस चल रहा है, तो हमें पर्सनली लाइबल मत हेल्ड करो. बट कोर्ट हैज सेड नो, डिस्पाइट ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट IBC इज हेल्पिंग इन द रिकवरी ऑफ द डिफॉल्ट मनी, बट इफ यू हैव गिवन अ पर्सनल गारंटी, देन योर पर्सनल असेट्स कैन ऑल्सो बी टेकन टू पे फॉर दोज defaults. So the apex court has given the approval of the resolution plan under IBC. It does not just discharge the personal guarantors of their liabilities towards the banks. Now, how can this move be helpful? Obviously, it will help in recovery of more and more defaulted money. It will be a boost for lenders as it allows them to seek recovery from the guarantors of loans. Then it will speed up the efforts by lenders to clear one of the worst piles of bad loans. So bad loans ko recover karne mein help karega. Okay, more debt realization hoga. And it will invoke personal guarantors act as a deterrent against default. Now, if I am a promoter and my company has taken a loan on my guarantee, मेरे को loan मिला है, जैसे मेरी कोई company है, मेरी guarantee पे उस company को loan मिला है, and if I default on that loan, I will be personally held liable. So I'll make sure that I run the business in a proper manner so that the situation doesn't come up that I have to default. So this way, the personal guarantees can act as a deterrent against default. हम ऐसा काम नहीं करेंगे कि company default कर जाए और loan ना repay कर पाए, क्योंकि हमें ही फिर वो pay करना पड़ेगा. That's why it will help as a deterrent against defaults. So if I move back to the question, it talked about that which purposes this move will not serve. It is going to serve the purpose of boosting the lenders and allowing them to recover dues. So this is not an objective it will not serve, क्योंकि ये objective वो serve करेगी ये move. Then with this judgment we can expect more debt realization. Yes, we can expect more debt realization. So ये भी answer नहीं हो सकता. Invoking personal guarantees can act as a deterrent, ये भी true है. तो इनमें से कोई ऐसा statement नहीं है जो वो purpose state करता है जो ये move serve नहीं करेगी. So answer is none of the above. If it has been, अगर यहाँ पे not word ना लिखा होता, so which of the following purpose this move serves? It serves all these purposes. Because they have written not, so there's no move which it doesn't serve out of these three. This was all for today's session. With this, I would like to end up this session. I hope it was useful for you. Thank you so much.